How many people in this room have an iPhone? Okay, a lot of you, almost all of you. that's pretty impressive. How many of you live in Europe? Okay, also. All right, so they are coming in slowly but surely. All right, so once, as soon as everyone gets seated, I will begin. All right. Hello. All right, I'm just gonna wait 20 more seconds for the rest of the people to come in, and then we'll get started. All right, so my name is Vivian Rosenthal from New York City. I'm the CEO and founder of Goldrun. Goldrun's an augmented reality mobile platform that uses GPS, so not QR codes, not webcams, and virtual goods to offer consumers real world rewards. And before I start to go into the platform and what it is, I sort of wanted to let you know why I'm here and think something that relates to all of us, but basically I was used to be an architect, and I was an architect that was seduced by the idea of technology, by the promise of technology, by the promise of a new reality. And I think this seduction around this new reality is what I call digital seduction. It's something that almost all of us here are really subject to. And so I think while obviously, the digital world is something that is becoming very much a part of all of us. We need to think about the offline world. So it was the web that brought us all online, right? Every brand, every person needs an online identity. We wouldn't have thought that originally, but now it's almost embarrassing if a brand doesn't have a web presence. And it's going to be augmented reality that's going to bring us all offline. And this is going to happen not overnight, but in the next 5 to 10 years. And it's really going to be a radical shift. And this is when our digital and physical realities are going to start to collide and slide and reform. And literally, this hybrid existence is something that we are all going to partake in. I'm going to start by showing some examples that talk about this convergence between the online and the offline worlds, first in the retail space and then in the gaming space. So this is a campaign we did with Young & Rubicam and Airwalk. And traditionally, obviously, with retail, you want to get people to a brick-and-mortar store. And we thought, well, what about, you know, what if we invert that? What if we actually bring product virtually to where the people are? So where does their demographic hang out? And let's, you know, on online, you have e-commerce. Well, offline, we have v-commerce, virtual commerce. So I'm going to show a quick case study that explains how this works. You can turn up the audio.
This is an Airwalk store. And so is this. They are the world's first invisible pop-up stores. Stores that can be set up anywhere at any time. Simply by using smartphones, geolocation, and augmented reality. We created them for the limited edition relaunch of the Airwalk Gym, a sneaker originally made for kids who hang out in skate parks or on the beach instead of going to gym class. So that's where we set up the stores. Because the marketing budget was small, we relied on bloggers to get the word out. And on November 6th, 2010, the stores went live for one day. To get the gym, people had to be in the right location, so they downloaded the Goldrun app, found the store, found the shoe, and bought it. It got a lot of buzz. Airwalk got $5 million worth of earned media, and their e-store had its busiest weekend ever.
Tell me what augmented reality shopping is and why that's going to be a big deal this year.
Augmented reality is pretty rad. For example, in New York City, we've got an invisible store where if you're in the right location and you put your phone up, you can see a whole Airwalk store.
An exclusive product sold to an exclusive audience for an entirely new retail experience.
They're a cool style, and I'm glad they're back, and I'm going to get a pair today.
The Invisible Pop-Up Store. Watch out for the next one invisibly appearing near you.
So what you just saw are these, what we're calling sort of geofenced hot zones, and we could make something as like a park a hot zone. We could make a, you know, giant stadium. We could make a big sporting stadium a hot zone, a music event, or literally the entire country. So in this next example, this is a campaign that was just launched a few days ago. It was a combination of NBC and Bloomingdale's. And you think, well, why would a retailer want to work with an entertainment property, with a TV network? Well, NBC was launching their new fall lineup of shows, one of which was called the Playboy Club. And Bloomingdale's obviously wants to drive traffic to their store. So what we did was we actually took the characters from the show, turned them into augmented reality objects, and GPS linked them to every Bloomingdale's across the country in the US. So suddenly with Airwalk, you know, you have virtual commerce. In the case of this campaign, you were really using it as a virtual photo booth. So Bloomingdale's is happy, they're getting foot traffic in the door. NBC is having really, really personal engagement with the consumers. So all of a sudden, the actors from their favorite shows, it's no longer this sort of passive experience online. It's an interactive, visually engaging experience in the offline world. So I'm going to show just a quick video.
Goldrun teamed up with Bloomingdale's to bring the stars of NBC's new fall shows right to your fingertips. Using the free Goldrun app, shoppers could head to the nearest Bloomingdale's store and take their place on the red carpet alongside virtual celebrities like Maria Bello and Christina Applegate, or wrap their arms around the bunnies of the Playboy Club. Shoppers shared their moment in the spotlight by emailing, Facebook posting, and tweeting their images, and vied for prizes like shopping sprees, trips to Hollywood, and even a walk-on role on an NBC program.
So those are all virtual.
Over 25,000 photos
people,
were taken.
Obviously, with the real people.
Images were shared online, and Bloomingdale's got
and this was over the course of just 3 days this was made, and obviously there was just huge engagement over the course of a really short time, bringing to life the characters from all the NBC fall shows. So if we sort of step back and think about, well, what does all of this mean? Well, it means that there's really, it's the Wild West, right? It's virtual real estate. Who owns it? No one owns it. Right now, we're looking to be the conduit to this world. So basically, think about a mall or an airport. And I'm a brand, and I don't have a physical store there, but I want to be there virtually. Well, Goldrun is a platform through our content management system allows the brands to license this virtual real estate from us. So it's literally a way to expand the presence of a brand in a totally new way. So we're thinking of it as a hybridized media buy. And obviously, again, you know, there's the sort of the creative uses of this are endless. So it's really not so much about the technology, but it's about thinking about how brands and ad agencies can take their existing campaigns, can take new campaigns, and bring those into the mobile space. I mean, the last quarter, you know, smartphone sales surpassed PC sales. Obviously, that's something that isn't going to change. And so we need to think about all these different ways that people can start to interact with product. And even interactive TV, we're working right now with HBO for a show called True Blood. We brought the characters into people's living rooms. So while you're watching the show, you can take photos with your favorite characters from the shows. And so these photographs become secondary marketing collateral for the brands. They can reuse them on Facebook, do different photo contests, and the people become engaged. So it's really the way Twitter is a communication platform through writing. Goldrun's a communication platform through visuals. And I really believe that, you know, visuals are going to be the language of the future. I mean, if you look at how kids communicate, it's through visuals. These are just some more images explaining how, we can take even interior spaces, this works inside, and offer discounts. We're doing a campaign coming up. It's called Visualize the Vote. And it's the idea of giving people who are under 18 in the U.S. the ability to vote, so to speak. So we're taking each of the candidates, turning them into augmented reality objects. They're going to be throughout the country. You can take a photo with the candidate that you're interested in. And these are going to be geotagged. Everything's obviously geotagged, right? So that's the whole point of augmented reality with longitude and latitude, which is exciting. So suddenly, you know, if I'm a kid, I can actually say who I support, and you're going to see that on a map start to populate. And then just thinking about, you know, how different uses, again, the virtual fitting room. So here you see a kid trying on a Disney dress. And all of the objects in our platform are scalable, so you can actually pinch and scale and adjust the size. They can be 3D, they can be 2D, they can be animated. And so now, again, we know that virtual goods is a booming economy, right? $2.1 billion in revenue in 2011. But I think what everyone's so focused on is online and Facebook and Farmville. But what if a virtual goods economy could be built offline? And I think it can, and that's what I'm planning to build with Goldrun. And so what does this mean? Well, think about it. You're playing a game online. You're playing a social game. And say you've, you know, you just unlocked a character, or you've won a dragon, or you've bought something. And, well, it exists on your computer screen. And, well, that's not extremely personal exciting. But, well, what if those characters all of a sudden had geographic specificity? What if I unlocked a dragon, and I could put it in my backyard? I could send it to my best friend, and it lived there forever. Well, that's now possible with the platform we built. So literally, the idea of bringing games from either the mobile space or the social space, online, even console games, and bringing those into our real-world settings is what we're doing with our platform. We're just launching our first collaboration with a game publisher in 2 weeks, and if there are any game publishers in the room, we'd love to work with you too. So, and we also are doing scavenger hunts. So here you see different point values attached to different characters. So we have a leaderboard and a point system. So you could have a month-long scavenger hunt. We're going to be doing one with Coca-Cola around fitness, probably because they feel guilty for feeding us all that sugar. So you know, you have a scavenger hunt around your city. You have to go around, collect different Coca-Cola characters. Those, and you sort of accrue points. In the end of it, there's different winners. This just shows sort of the point system and map view. And again, you know, this whole idea of avatars, certainly we're all very familiar with them now, thanks to, you know, Xbox and Sony PlayStation and everything. But bringing them into the offline world, I think, is where this is going to get really exciting, where I can, you know, for instance, gift someone, it's my best friend's birthday and they're across the country or across the world, I can send them 3D flowers that are going to appear in their home. They can take a photo of themselves or their family with the flowers and send it back to me. So there's a full loop. So really, I think the physical world as we all know it is never going to be the same. Thank you so much. I'm Vivian from Goldrun.
Thank you, Vivian. Have safe travels.
Thank you.
The reason why Vivian is not telling you who has won the competition on the Goldrun app is because she needs to fly to London, and her plane is going in a minute. So more or less, she's in a hurry. We have another special innovation, but before that, we want to announce the winners of the Goldrun app. And can we please have the first winner up here? So maybe that person is still in the room. Can we have the picture, please, from the first winner? Here we go. Do you like that? Is that good? Is that a cool picture? Come on, give a hand. Good. Is that person in the room? Seems it's not in the room. Well, just so you know what the winners get, they get a voucher for next year's DMEXCO, which is on the, it's a hotel voucher for the 2 days. It's from the 12th to the 13th of September, and I hope to see you all here then. Can we have the second picture as well, please? Okay, also nice picture, nice rabbit. Is that person here? Can't see it. Okay, and number three. Is that person here? Yeah? Cool. So at least we see one person here. Come up on stage. We have your email address, but just to see how this person is really looking, so that's the real person behind it. So offline and online differ a bit sometimes, as we see. Okay, we have your address, your email address. Yep. You don't have to give me your business cards, at least if you want to. That's mine then. Thank you very much. Good. Congratulations. And we have the last but not least, well, last but probably one of the most interesting presentations for the gaming industry now. We have two people that will be telling you how to unlock the potential of a new interactive media channel, and they will be talking about, obviously, gaming and social gaming. The people up on stage are from Spilgames, the Chief Commercial Officer. Please welcome Sidney Mock. And we also have from SocialVibe, the EMEA Sales Managing Director, Mr. Richard Reeves. Good. Stage is yours.
Thank you. Well, if I may just kick off, Sidney. We've heard a lot about social media over these last couple of days, social gaming and the challenges faced by advertisers who are seeking to harness, if you like, the potential of this media channel. Tell us, how big is social gaming?
I will definitely tell you in a minute, because I think it's really challenging to be here on stage at the last session. We just heard a very talented and passionate woman from New York, and now we have to try to close this session in a way which is rewarding for the audience.
Indeed. So
I think the first reward, what we promise you, is we don't show you any PowerPoint slide anymore. I think you've seen enough of them for the last couple of days, and I really, really want to thank you for being here during the last session. We got a big challenge ahead of us from the organizers, who said we need to leave you this room very motivated, and we'll try our best. If not, have a beer at one of the stands, which are definitely open after 50 minutes. So, come back to your question, how big is gaming?
Indeed.
How big is social gaming? Well, let me first start with explaining a bit to the ones who don't know exactly what it is. What's our definition of social gaming? So social games are basically games which interact with the social graph on the internet. So it could be, of course, a social network, but also, in the case of our company, a game or social gaming platform where we also added a social graph. So it's a gaming connecting to the social graph, so basically to for yourself, your own profile and your friend list, and you can share, communicate, play with your friends. You can invite your friends in the game, you can go to the games of your friends, and there's really a lot of interaction between the players and between your real life friends. Now the size of the global gaming industry is estimated at $60 billion globally, and 65% of that part is console and PC gaming, and 35% is the revenues are based on online gaming and wireless gaming. And it's expected that in 4 years' time, the allocation between PC console and online wireless will be 50-50. And that's much driven by the social gaming and the virtual items which you can buy in the social games. Now, if you look at the audience, at the gamers, of course, Facebook, biggest example, of the 700 million users, roughly 50% of them play social games, and every other check-in on Facebook is game related. And if you would add the top five of most popular social games currently on Facebook, they attract 220 million monthly active users. So I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, to some degree it does. But in your opinion, why do you believe social gaming is actually so popular? Why this scale?
Well, there's a couple of reasons for that. First of all, you see the big underlying trends. So globally, I mean, not only in the Western world, but also in Asia, Africa, Latin America, we see a rise of internet penetration, and added to that, the increase of broadband within that internet population. And then the massive growth of and popularity of social networks. Everybody knows, of course, the Facebook example. But don't forget, we have lots and lots of local social networks. So in Europe, of course, here in Germany, VZ networks. We got Hives in the Netherlands, Nasdaq in Poland, 20 in Spain, Sonico in Latin America, and so on and so on. So there's a huge, huge amount of people who are actively engaging in these social networks. Now, in the social games, as I explained before, you play with your real friends. So actually with the people you know, your friends, your family, maybe some colleagues. And the entry barriers to start playing the games are very, very low. So you, on Facebook, you download, of course, an app one time. But on many other platforms, you just play. You don't have to download the game. If the game starts, there's almost always a tutorial. So there's a couple of minutes which teach you through the basics of the game. And then you just start playing. And you can ask help from your friends, or you just find out by yourself. But basically what the popularity also accelerates is what we call appointment gaming. So all these games got in-game triggers, which basically ask you to return and to finish your game, to go to the next level, to earn more credits or to earn more points. And I would say last but not least, if you go to the game categories, the social game categories, there are very close to people's interest. So whether it's a farm or a hospital or a restaurant or a mafia game or poker, they're all very much attached and connected to the interest of the users. So that's. But let me ask you a question. So, as in any industry, it's also very interesting to understand what are the monetization opportunities within the social gaming industry.
Indeed, and I think that always remains the biggest challenge. Social games are obviously played for free, and I think Vivian obviously touched on this in her presentation. But one source of revenue for publishers of games has been to encourage the user to acquire credits or virtual currency, which enables them to obviously enhance their experience, provides them access to premium levels, opportunities, again, as Vivian was saying, to create avatar accessories, etc. But I think also one important point on that is for the publishers, that's extremely profitable because, unlike in the real world, there's none of the associated costs, such as the manufacturing, the distribution, and the storage of the product. But I think in 2010, slightly different to Vivian's number, that element of the industry was worth over $7.4 or $7.3 billion. And it's predicted to actually rise to over $14 billion by 2014. However, whilst it seems like a relatively impressive number, the reality is, and this really is the reality, that it's only a very, very small proportion of those sites, of those games traffic, that are actually able to monetize. And it leads to the bigger question, which is, you know, how do game publishers successfully monetize at a greater proportion of their traffic? And what we're seeing at the moment is a number of different models being experimented with. And I think there's absolutely no doubt now that the audience that social games offer, both in terms of scale and demographic, offers a very real opportunity for brands, but it's equally important that the publishers and advertisers seek, as they do, to develop these variety of advertising models intended to provide engaging advertising solutions. They must, at all times, remember to make sure that advertising experience that they offer is non-disruptive to the consumer. It's extremely important. We've already heard over these last couple of days exactly how passionate the users of social media and social gaming are in terms of their consumption, and to interrupt the consumer's experience has a very negative impact, and the connotations are extremely negative potentially for both the publisher and for the advertiser. We've looked at bigger brands who certainly over the last couple of years have explored and experimented with in-game advertising. And I think some of these solutions are very interesting, especially if they replicate the real-world product and create that synergy in the virtual world. And they're good stunts, and they're quite impactful. They generate a considerable amount of PR, but they're also extremely cost-prohibitive. I think this is something that we all need to consider, that if you undertake an in-game build, you've got the consideration for the technical and design costs to consider there. And in reality, you know, whilst it's impactful, it's in terms of the PR and the initial stunt, it's relatively limited in its effect, perhaps no more limited than ambient media. And ultimately, of course, what it does mean is that the brands themselves, who ultimately crave for that direct dialogue with the consumer, they're not able to achieve that in this instance, and that is something obviously they crave. I mean, the solution I personally advocate, and one that I firmly believe is in the right place, is one that sees the advertising experience woven into the consumer's experience and the publisher's offering. What we do know is that more than half of the social media users currently out there are willing to be exposed to advertising messages in return for a benefit, and that benefit being that enables them to obtain the experience that they're seeking. The most effective way, obviously, to deliver this is to provide a solution that is completely and utterly controlled by the consumer. So by that, I mean 100% initiated by the consumer. So, I mean, if you like, they're on their journey, they're playing their social game, and they come to a point in that journey where they have the opportunity, or they're presented with a need, if you like, to apply virtual currency or undertake some form of transaction to be able to continue with that journey. And I think at that point, if they have the opportunity to elect, alternatively, to engage with an advertising message at that point, thus providing, if you like, their active attention for a short period of time in return for that reward, that benefit. That's what we call the value exchange, if you like. And that reward is then the virtual currency or the access to the area that they desire to achieve to continue their journey. But, I mean, again, back to you. I mean, given your active experience in terms of developing revenues for Spiel, what has been and remains the biggest challenge when talking to agencies?
Well, I think, and I truly believe that with any new format and every new media or in this case social gaming, it starts with education of the market. Mm. So we go out and we talk a lot to the agencies, to the strategy directors, to the planners, to everybody who wants to listen and wants to hear the new story. And basically we talk about three things. So first of all, and I think that's most important, it's a mass audience we're talking about. This is not a niche, this is not a hype. We're talking about hundreds of millions of players who are coming to these games every day and multiple times a day. So there's even a comparison in the US where Farmville is compared to the hit series on TV, and they're equal in size of viewers versus viewers. So that's first, it's a mass audience, it's a mass market. Secondly, is what we call, it's a new media, so it's a new interactive format, I think, as you explained. I mean, there's a reason why in the old days the radio spots weren't aired on TV, right? And there's a reason also why you don't put your standard display ads within social games. So it's time for a new way of communicating with the users. And last but not least is that, as you explained, the engagement and the interaction with the user, that's the key. With that comes the metrics, so you can measure everything, and you see a whole variety of criteria where you can measure the success of your campaign and the interaction of your brand or your product with the user. And as you know, probably better than I do, that we've seen exceptional results in these campaigns.
I think if we thought about this in advance and this room was full of agency people, we could have demonstrated. I think our proposition would have been, for listening to us for the last 15 minutes, there's a taxi outside with your name on, waiting to take you to the airport, and your fare's been covered. That would be the perfect way of demonstrating exactly what we mean by a value exchange. Thank you, Sidney.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much. That was a good speech. Thanks for that.